Very good evening to all of you. Respected Shailek Nayak sir, Dr. Christopher, the senior dignitaries of Asian countries, and all my colleagues from ISRO. First of all, let me thank Shailek Nayak sir to give an opportunity for me to talk in this very, very rare occasion on the Asian Conference on Remote Sensing. When I just entered here, only one thing is remember to me, the Asians really contributed for the space technology as we are seeing today. Just to start with this particular thing, we are seeing how the rocketry in the world begin. It mainly began from our Chinese friends. Maybe around 5,000 years back, this Chinese research and development scientist was looking for elixir, mainly to increase their lifespan. Accidentally, they invented the gunpowder. Whether they got the gunpowder for extending their life, but really it is really serving for the human society now after 5,000 years. And this gunpowder they were using mainly for the festival seasons, for celebrating this particular thing. Even one gentleman used the gunpowder make rocket. He kept many such rocket under the chair. He asked the other people to ignite. He wanted to go to heaven. I don't know how he got gone, but he was disappeared. He would have gone directly to the heaven, not by the rocket, by burn explosion of the rocket. That would have happened. The story goes like that. And this rocket, this gunpowder, really giving the precursor of the solid propellant motor, which we have been using heavily in our space system. When you talk about the first application of the solid rocket motor for a application, strategic application, by another Asian, that is our great Tipu Sultan. He made small rockets with the iron cased tubes with a 2 to 3 inches diameter and about 8 inch long rocket. This rocket really provide a range of 2 kilometers, and he uses a warhead, and he have all the new technologies, whatever we have, he implemented at that time in his rocket. Basically, towards end of the rocket, he kept the sword. The sword was used as a payload, whatever we are talking about, nuclear warhead now we are talking, but he used the sword as the payload. Also, he used this sword as the stabilizing platform. What happened is this trajectory was very, very fantastic trajectory. If anybody going through the trajectory of this rocket, it's a very, very, very nicely designed trajectory. Towards the end of the trajectory, the whole rocket will tumble and it will go on, cut whatever they're available in the space, in the nearby area. That way, he used this rocket in the Srirangapatnam War in 1792, and he won the war. The British colonel, that William Congreve, he participated in that British war, but he was defeated in that war. He was wondering what really happening. In fact, he is trying to understand what the new technology the Indians have used, and he has taken this rocket to England and trying to create his own rocket. That is, he called the Congreve rockets. It's a copy of Indian Tipu Sultan rocket, and he used this one in 1807. In the Copenhagen War, and he won. And I would say that you can see that in all this activity, the applications of the rocket as a weapon, it is initiated from India, but after India was silent for nearly 170 years, for various reasons, that you know the reasons I need not explain the thing. Even though we have initiated the rocketry from here, finally, we end up with trying to look for the rocketry from other country. That is the irony, whatever we have. But what I wanted to tell is, this rocketry area, there are some modern pioneers, not only in India, parallelly, the pioneers, I would say the many, many pioneers were there. Specifically, there is one mathematics teacher, school teacher, Konstantin Tioskovsky. He designed the modern rocket, whatever we are talking, liquid oxygen, liquid hydrogen, at 1903 itself. And this is the type of drawings he made. And our rockets are not very much away from this. That is a very interesting part. In USA, Professor Goddard, he made a rocket in 1926. And all of us are aware that the famous V2 rocket by German scientist Werner von Braun, that was making havoc in that the World War. Parallelly, the Russians, the Sergei Korolev also made an effort. All the rocket, what is Sputnik or Vostok or Soyuz, we are right now we are talking, it is his design. And no change in the design. And how the time history of the space race begin? Once this USSR started, the next giant, USA also started parallelly. This was a tug of war between these two giants. Initially, that Russians were in the peak. Finally, at the towards the end, this specifically, that USA also come to the picture, and they were dominating the space arena. When this fight was going on between the two giants, mainly to show their military dominance, our Indian, the great Professor Dr. Vikram Sarabhai, he was thinking in a different way. Because this technology was used for dominating others. Whether we can use this technology for us, our purpose, mainly because the reason is our country is a very, very lengthy, wider, nearly 80% of the population living in the remote area or rural area, or urban people are very limited. How to make use of this technology for the development of the country? Mainly, he was looking for to get unbiased technology applications for that every one of our Indian who are working almost 80% of the population in the remote area. Something, different technology than conventional technology required. He thought that this is the only technology can provide the unbiased benefit to the entire nation. And with this intention, only he made a vision for Indian space program. Mainly, only thing is, what the vision Professor Sarabhai he made was to get the uninterrupted service, to get a cost-effective service, our system should be totally indigenous. So based on his vision, now Indian Space Research Organization has raised to the occasion. Now we have developed the entire technology on all three key areas, that is space transportation system, satellite systems, or ground support system. All three areas are totally indigenous, and we brought these academics and industry also in the picture to support the program. Now, how we started in a very humble way. 53 years back, that is 1963, the 21st November, the first rocket took off from a fishing village in Thiruvananthapuram, Kerala, towards the southern part of India. This is like actually, it is something similar to the startup whatever we are having nowadays. Because at that time, no resources. So he really talked to the church father and make use of the church as a research lab. And this particular location was selected mainly because it was above the magnetic equator. And from that particular point onwards, the development of the rocketry in a very humble way started. In 20th November, that is 1967, the first indigenous rocket took off from Indian soil, the same place. That is, this is with the 75 millimeter diameter rocket, it's a pencil rocket. From that, now we are going up to 4-ton satellite carrying capability vehicle. Regarding the satellite area, we started one major the experiment called the SITE, that is the Satellite Instruction Delivery Experiment. This was the largest sociological experiment. This is what same as whatever we are talking D2H experiment, the direct-to-home experiment he did to bring the TV programs to the villages, and the huge numbers of students, teachers, as well as village farmers made use of that. Parallelly, the development happened on the satellite area also. Now, we are having a satellite with a high-throughput satellite, the same GSLV-MA3 launched in June, high-throughput satellite. All these satellites now making real the benefits to the common people in many areas, this one. And if you are seeing that time history, as I said, the Indian started using rocket as a weapon in 1792, but there was a lull period for 170 years, but we could make up. Now, even though we started slightly late, but we are catching up by bringing many, many research and development in the areas of material science, space science, and the propulsion system, and industrial participation also there. Now, with all those things, now, even though we started late, at least we are number one in launching maximum number of satellite in one mission, that is the PSLV C-37 in last February, this one. And to achieve this one, how the organization set up is like this. ISRO contained mainly that three parts. One is launch vehicle side, spacecraft side, and ground service. We are bringing academia and industry for benefiting us. And basically, the launch vehicles are providing their national the requirements of satellite, commercial satellite, and student satellite also is launching. The spacecraft have a different areas of that applications in terms of Earth observation, satellite positioning, communication, and other things. And along with that, we have some innovative services like e-governance, societal, socio-economic security, disaster management, and sustainable development. To do all these things, what the type of the vehicle technology we have? We started our launch vehicle technology 40 kg satellite at SLV-3. Now, we are talking about 4-ton satellite launching capability, GTO. Not only that one, in order to meet the future requirements, the research and development that happened, we have shown the scramjet engine, the demonstration, the reusable launch vehicle technology demonstrations, and we are already developing the semi-cryogenics engine to meet the future high-thrust engine and the high-power satellite requirement, the launch vehicle requirement, as well as the re-entry technologies for in the area of the human space program. Now, in the satellite area, if you are talking, again, here we are talking about the requirements in the Earth observations area, many, many satellites we have, and the communications area also we have many satellites, and weather applications, then planetary science also we have. At present, what are the type of satellite, the spacecraft assets we have? We have 34 satellites providing that wide spectrum of applications in the area of that remote sensing, communications, navigations, and the planetary science. In short, these satellites is really providing applications in the area of the safety, security, and quality of humans in all the walks of life in India. Also, it is having very interesting applications like telemedicine, teleeducation, and many, many, such almost every area it is taking care. Because of the use of the space application, the government has taken so much initiative. In fact, our Honorable Prime Minister used to tell this particular phrase that no space should be between common man and space technology. This is a mantra he is using. He himself conducted a national meet on the usage of space technology for the common people. Is it mainly to for plan, collaborate, and deliver? And different areas of management were identified. And all these space technologies take part in the the government flagship program of this one. In short, what we can say is the space, once again I'm reiterating that it is mainly required for every area. Space technology has the widest and most unbiased reach, and it nowadays it's very difficult to imagine the life, modern life, without space technology. All these things really require a space transportation system to launch a satellite. If you are talking about that, what is the requirement for the space transportation system? As you are aware, we need to place a satellite at a specific orbit at a particular altitude. The satellite should be injected with a velocity of a specific speed. If you are converting this speed and altitude in terms of energy, what we talk about, the energy requirement is something like 57 megajoules per kg or 33 megajoules per kg. This type of energy we can get only through a chemical propulsion. In chemical propulsion, the chemical energy, entire energy is stored as a chemical energy. The chemical energy is converted into thermal energy. This thermal energy is again converted into kinetic energy. And using that Newton's third law, we are getting the velocity to the vehicle as per whatever required. To get a meaningful mission, what we want to have is our vehicles are like this. As I said, the entire vehicle is a chemical energy, containing chemical energy, explosives. To have the explosions, we need a controlled explosion only we want. So if you are seeing that the entire vehicle is explosives, that is something like 86 or 87% of the vehicle is explosives. Only thing is, to ensure the controlled explosion, we have the remaining part is through the structural mass or engine, all other things. Just to see, compare how this is comparing with a conventional aircraft. Aircraft, you have seen that 55% of the aircraft is the structural mass to ensure the safety and security to the people, whereas the 22% is the payload. Whereas we have in our vehicle, instead of 58%, only 12%. At the same time, it is the systems are working in the extreme conditions to give the best performance. To ensure that the best performance, how the performance of the systems look like, just I want to tell. If you're saying that the typical rocket engine, we're saying it is giving something like 37 million HP power. It is equivalent to the 13 Hoover Dam's power. And one pump in the engine, it is producing a power equivalent to 28 locomotives engine. We are talking about extreme temperature up to 3,200 Kelvin. And the pressures that order of this three-digit number. But to do all those things, the allowable, the structure or system is so benign, so low. So basically, this makes the system very, very complex. Why it's complex is, it's working in a very, very harsh environment. At the same time, it is a very highly optimized design, and we have very high power to weight ratio system. Then the system is so fully autonomous, no second chance is given, and redundancy cannot be put, and we need a high reliability requirement. The system should be multidisciplinary in nature, and that the technologies of very, very critical technology or strategic nature is not available to anybody. And at the same time, the limited scientific knowledge only available. All systems require the limits of the industrial capacity and the synergy with other domain. Because of these things, there are only two states in the launch vehicle, either success or failure. There must be a design trade-off, the system engineering. All these things lead to the whole system's like a line between success and failure is very, very thin in the launch vehicle. But ISRO could do all those things. How? We have research in two areas. One is academics, another is industrial research. Academic research basically is looking for a fundamental research and looking for different options, but no focused one. But the research will be available in lab level. That lab level research is made into industrial research, which made a very focused research, and we brought and we have made this research as a useful product. One such product is our beloved PSLV, whatever we are talking. This PSLV, it has launched the satellite in many, many orbits, and it is not only our national satellite, it is launched that our customer satellite from other countries. It has transported more than 50 tons of that the items to the space from Indian satellite, and around 6.5 tons of other the foreign satellite also it launched. It has a very good track record. This particular vehicle has gone everywhere in the space, not only low Earth orbit, not only that geo transfer orbit or navigation orbit, it even gone to moon, then it gone to up to even Mars. And with these things, we got now a new vehicle called GSLV Mark 3, which is launching 4-ton satellite into space. This vehicle is a 100% indigenous vehicle. The cryogenic engine, whatever we used here, also is totally indigenous. And now we are not going to stop with that. We are going to proceed further. But this is not the one. This technology, whatever we used or we have developed for the space transportation system, we wanted to make use of the technology as a spin-off for the common people also. The typical one, what we are talking is many, many technology we developed as a part of launch vehicle system. The typical one, the lithium-ion cell, nowadays you would have seen it in the newspaper, how lithium-ion cells are being used. Whatever the space technology, the space developed the system is going to be used in the road transport system. And we have many, many systems like silica aerogel and polyurethane foot and all, many, many applications. In addition to that, the space transportation system, it is used for direct application as a spin-off. Now, all these things is not the end of the story. What is next? Definitely, the customer need a better satellite services and the low cost access they want. They want the mission to be very, very complex because they want to get the best out of that. All this can be achieved by advanced satellite in an efficient launch vehicle. At the same time, we wanted to have a sustained space program. All this can be happened by technology development, technology demonstration, and technology roadmap. It's not only for India, the whole world. This is evolving the process. And in this process, what a new technology being emerged, what is that? That is nothing but a small. When you are talking about a bigger vehicle, now people talk about a smaller vehicle. How the smaller vehicle become important? Just I want to tell. When the whole world was appreciating and praising that our PSLV launch with the 104 satellite at a single mission, there was an innovative technology behind that. It was not brought to the attention much. That was nothing but a startup company, Planet Lab from USA. They launched 88 small satellites from these missions. What these small satellites doing? You can ask, so what? We are seeing this small satellite, the coverage it has provided. It is so large. It is covering the entire globe. All these satellites are not research and development satellite. It is a real Earth observation satellite providing services in many observation areas. And why is a speciality of this particular service is to get this type of global coverage, we need many number of satellites. If we are using the present satellite system, it is so costly, it is unwieldy. Instead of using multiple, very, very costly satellite, a multiple small satellite with the cost of a single satellite can do the job. That is the breakthrough, I would say. Now, with this one, it is not the only one. You can see that throughout the world, the small satellite, the technology is growing, mainly that below 100 kg type of satellite. that mainly that around 5 to 10 kg, the nano satellites are picking up very fast. And there was a global scenarios. Yes, there is the trend is increasing, but all these predictions are based on the present technology. This trend may increase further or may reduce, all depends on this. Well, the important part of what I want to tell is, the out of all the countries, India only launched the maximum number of small satellites. So we wanted to still capture this particular opportunity. And what type of satellite, basically, this the small satellites are really doing? We are seeing that before 2013, the small satellites are mainly in the research and development area. And the real revenue earning satellites are coming after 2014, mainly on the Earth observation. Another one is that even though Earth observation small satellites are picking up, there is a small gap in the communication area, but communication area also now picking up. Now, the other, the industries, the private industries, now getting into this communication, yeah, that is going to be a major chunk. This one, and what is the communication requirement? If you are seeing that, by there's a prediction by 2020, there's a demand for 44 zettabyte requirement, and this is going to be increased by 44 times in 11 years. Just imagine what is the type of requirement for data transfer. If you wanted to use that the terrestrial system for all these things, our the globe will be, or Earth will be full of towers and cables only. There will not be any place for even doing the agriculture. So only space available in space. It is essential that we have to go to space. That's what basically this particular small satellites come into the picture. Instead of using the high throughput single satellite, they are telling that multiple small satellites, clusters we can use. There are the key players, they are coming to the picture. We can see that worldwide, not only the small satellites, a lot of that is the constellation also is planned. But all this constellation now, that is whether launches are ready to take up the job. At present, the small satellites are going in the piggyback mode. We are waiting for the launch opportunity to be that waiting for the launch vehicle. And whatever launch vehicle they are providing only, these people are that are really accepting. Now, what is really doing? Basically, the small satellite people are ending up with a non-optimal inclination or altitude, and they are always given that a secondary situation, the citizen treatment. They are not given a primary citizen treatment, and they are also delayed very much. And even sometimes that they may not even deploy the satellite. They will tell that you go ahead with our final stage. We cannot do anything for. But what is that world scenario? Now the scenario is different because all small satellites are picked up by the startup. They are doing the business. They don't want any money. They are adequately funded by the respected the business team. And only thing is, they wanted a revenue, the generation-based business they wanted. So they cannot wait. They want the satellite to be launched as and when they required. Also, they cannot take whatever satellite orbit we are giving. They want the satellite, what the requirement of mission, what they want. Now, that is, the scenario becomes changing because they want a capability on demand. They want a quick turnaround time, and they also more mission flexibility, and at the same time, they want to be more and more cost-effective because that always they look for a business. They want to be more cost-effective and more reliable and mass-producible. Now, to capture this type of huge market, there's a mad rush throughout the world. More than the 30 small satellite launch vehicle developers they started, they are mostly the startups. We can see that how they are giving. Earlier we are talking about NASA, ESA, like that only we are talking. Now, how many people are coming? Not only this many, many, many people. And they are the way they are giving service, they are at least in the available literature is amazing. Whatever the cost of launch we are talking, they are talking one third or even sometimes one tenth of the cost only they are talking. How they can do it, that one. Our the conventional team, that the designers, they were always looking for conventional design. And our conventional people, or what I'm saying, the present generation like ISRO people, they don't want to take any risk because they want to be more safe and no innovation. And because of that one, the system became more complex and costly. But the startup people, it's a good that they are having some kind of blessing in disguise. They are not knowing about rocketry, so they are innovating. Because of innovation, definitely the system becomes more simple and less costly. Sometimes it may fail, but still they are taking risk. That way, they are ready to take risk. And some of the technology, what they want to do is like extensive use of composites, the automated production, even additive even engine itself, they are doing additive manufacturing. And we are using pump, the turbo pumps for the pumping the fuel, but they are using that electric motors for pumping the fuel. And microelectronic mechanical system that they are maximally using. And instead of using a space qualified event, they wanted to use that commercial off-the-shelf items on avionics. And with this, not only that one, they wanted to think launching the Saturn in a different way. We are thinking the rocket means like a pencil type of structure, but people are talking about like box type of structure. Pencil type of structure is mainly required to make the vehicle fly through atmosphere. And if the atmospheric disturbance is not there, they can have a box type of vehicle. This is one type of that I think balloon launch they are calling. This is the one way they are thinking. That's definitely this advantage, but this required more development effort. Another the effort that what they are doing is that our air launch. This is another way of thinking. Instead of always launching from that launch base, is a different way of thinking. One advantage about this particular type of launches, like if you are talking about that our air launch, we don't require any big launch base like a shark. We can go anywhere, take the rocket to a place where you want, and you can launch from there. That way we can gain the whatever required. But only thing is this also required more development effort. But what is our perspective? What we thought it is our duty when the world is going towards a small satellite launcher, we also should go into that small satellite launch vehicle. And that you should launch something like a 500 kg satellite into the orbit, low Earth orbit. At the same time, it should be available at any time, shortest time, and the lowest cost. If you are using, make use of the existing the heritage system, what really happened is that the payload will be more than what are required. The cost of launching is very, very large. So we have to have a new system, a small satellite launch vehicle system, that must tune to meet the requirement. We made some analysis. As a launch per cost per kg of satellite or launch cost, around that 500 kg satellite launch, we need a vehicle. We can have a vehicle with 20 to 30 crore. This is one order less than the existing vehicle cost. That way, this is going to be a major the breakthrough in ISRO's launch vehicle technology. And we wanted to do the whole thing in a very, very fastest turnaround time, that 15 months, because we cannot go behind the other people, so we have to be number one to capture this market. That is the effort. And we want to make use of the available infrastructure as well as that commercial item for avionics system. And we wanted to bring more and more onboard intelligence into the system. The vehicle will be looking something like this. And it's having main characteristics of ease of manufacturing, ease of handling the stages, and the capability on demand launch. And the possibility of launch anytime, anywhere, and more mission flexibility. Main technology challenges are, we wanted the mobile launch control center, and artificial intelligence system we wanted to bring in everywhere, so that a huge 600, 700 people required for launching one vehicle is not required. We wanted to send only 3 people to the shore, and they will go and assemble the rocket and launch and using a laptop checkout system. The entire thing will be done by the vehicle, so the entire cost can be reduced drastically. The system will not be just like this one. This also have all the features of that a bigger vehicle or multiple satellite, a single bigger satellite, all those things we have. And at the same time, in compared to the existing small satellite launch vehicle in the elsewhere in the world, where we are. So there also we are no way away from them. So we are in line with other vehicle and cost wise also will be better. Now, how the systems development for this one? It is like many new developments are required, but already the development efforts have been initiated, and we are going to have the detailed discussions, review process, and the testing process very soon to have a launch at the earliest. Now, we are not only stopping with a small satellite, we have our own the roadmap to take care of our future requirement. That is, we talk about SSLV at the end, you can see that. But already we have that four-ton capability. This four-ton capability to GTO is, we have a plan to take it to the 16-ton, this zone. To reach that four-ton capacity, we took 50 years. From four-ton to 16-ton, we want to take in 5 years. That's the only difference. Definitely, we have matured the technology to achieve this one. Also, we have a very clear plan for reusable vehicle, to air-breathing vehicle to go to orbit and come. All these things required mainly to meet the demand of the satellite. That also, we have enough number of the satellite systems are the plan. And to meet this very high demand from the satellite system to put it, we need the launch vehicle roadmap is well defined, and we are going to work on this one to meet all this national demand. And once we are meeting the national demand, definitely we will provide the services for the commercial people also, so that the entire globe should be benefited by the space-based technology, so that every technology benefit from the space should reach the common people in a very cost-effective way. For that, ISRO is working on this one. Thank you very much, sir, for giving me the opportunity once again.